Okay, it's 10 o'clock. We have a full agenda today. I'd like to call the call to order the December meeting of the Board of Directors of Omaha Public Power District. Kim, would you please call them?
Barrett?
Yes.
Kavanaugh?
Here.
Gay?
Here.
Green?
Yes.
McGuire?
Here.
Mines?
Here.
Ulrich?
Here.
Weber. Agenda item number two, announcement regarding public notice of meeting. Notice of the time and place of this meeting was publicized by notifying the area news media, by publicizing same in the Omaha World-Herald and outlets, by displaying such notice on the arcade level of Energy Plaza since December 12, 2014, and by mailing such notice to each of the district's directors on that same date. A copy of the proposed agenda for this meeting has been maintained on a current basis and is readily available for public inspection in the office of the district's corporate secretary. Additionally, a copy of the open meetings law is available for public inspection in the public meeting book located in this meeting room. Agenda item number three, approval of the October 2014 comprehensive financial and operating reports and of November 13, 2014 minutes for the last meeting.
So moved.
Motion to second, Kim.
Barrett?
Yes.
Kavanaugh?
Yes.
Gay?
Yes.
Green?
Yes.
McGuire?
Yes.
Mines?
Yes.
Ulrich?
Yes.
Agenda item number four, persons wishing to address the Board of Directors on a particular item are asked to approach the microphone as that agenda item is discussed. Comments will be heard following board discussion of the item and prior to a vote by the board. Persons wishing to address the board on all other matters will have an opportunity before the close of the meeting. Agenda item number five, resolution number 6024. Now therefore be it resolved by the Board of Directors of the Omaha Public Power District that management is hereby authorized to use regulatory accounting to establish a regulatory asset for the net pension liability to levelize pension expense and match the recovery of pension costs through rates.
So moved.
Second.
The motion is second. John?
Yes, the Government Accounting Standards Board has instituted a new accounting standard for financial accounting reporting of pensions. This resolution brings us in line with that new GASP requirement and allows the district to take some of its pension liability and do what we call regulatory accounting. That's probably the extent of my understanding of regulatory accounting. But what it does is it passes the accounting phase over a longer period of time. But what it also, the more important thing on this, for not just for us, for everybody else that deals with this, is it takes the pension underfunding from a note in an annual report to a reported item. And by moving it from a note to the item, it has to be accounted for then when you visit with rating agencies and things like that as to what your liability is in terms of what your borrowing power should be. So that one of the things that it should do is encourage those governmental entities that let their pensions fall with the falling stock market and not replace what happened during that period of time to get on the ball and take care of that. So I would move this unless anybody has any questions. Anyone else?
It probably should be noted that we do have a net pension liability now of $338 million, and we have a plan, a 15-year plan, to bring that back up to 100%. And right now it's at about 73%, just so everybody's aware of that.
Is there any members of the public who wish to comment on this particular item? Seeing none, Kim, would you please vote?
Barrett?
Yes.
Kavanaugh?
Yes.
Gay?
Yes.
Green?
Yes.
McGuire?
Yes.
Mines?
Yes.
Ulrich?
Yes.
Agenda item number six, resolution number 6025, approval to, excuse me, now therefore be it resolved by the Board of Directors of the Omaha Public Power District to amend resolution 5976 to limit the use of regulatory accounting to plan nuclear refueling outages and remove the dollar threshold.
So moved.
Second.
John? Same thing I bet you're going to say.
No, I do know more about regulatory accounting. We have used the concept of regulatory accounting on the Fort Calhoun on the repair and restore. And what this resolution does is it applies that same accounting principle to major outages, such as the every 18-month fuel outage at Fort Calhoun and takedown of other coal-fired units for purposes of repairs and cleaning and all the things that you do about every other year. So that's what this applies to. And unless someone has any questions or someone wants to speak, and I can't understand why none of you want to come down and talk about regulatory accounting. That's it.
Yep.
Barrett?
Yes.
Kavanaugh?
Yes.
Gay? Green?
Yes.
McGuire?
Yes.
Mayans?
Yes.
Ulrich?
Yes.
Motion passed. Agenda item number 7, resolution number 6026, now therefore be resolved by the Board of Directors of the Omaha Public Power District that the Board hereby affirms that the 2015 expenditures incurred by the district will be reimbursed to the district from the proceeds of tax-exempt debts of the district, but only if the issuance of such debt is deemed to be desirable by the district. The adoption of this resolution is and constitutes the taking of affirmative action by the district acting through its Board of Directors to preserve the right and option of the district to issue tax-exempt debt to reimburse 2015 expenditures, which are incurred prior to the issuance of the district's debt.
So moved. Second.
Motion and second. John?
The IRS requires that if you wish to issue bonds for tax-exempt purposes, that you, as part of your operating plan or corporate operating plan, prior to the end of the prior fiscal year, that public utilities such as us sit down, take a look at what our borrowing needs are going to be for the next year and declare them ahead of time. And we do this every December, and that's what this resolution is.
Anyone else?
Just so it's noted, we don't, this doesn't mean we have to do it, it just means we could.
Correct.
Anyone from the audience care to comment on this item? Seeing no one. Kim?
Barrett?
Yes.
Kavanaugh?
Yes.
Gay?
Yes.
Green?
Yes.
McGuire?
Yes.
Mayans?
Yes.
Ulrich?
Yes.
Motion passed. Agenda item number 8, resolution number 6027. Now therefore be it resolved that the Board of Directors of the Omaha Public Power District hereby approves the 2015 corporate operating plan.
So moved.
Second.
And Mr. Easterling. Cool.
Cool. We got TVs.
So good morning. I'd like to provide an overview of the 2015 corporate operating plan and the electric service tariff updates. In 2015, we face a number of challenges and opportunities. New to the list is the completion of Nebraska City Unit 2 repairs. We looked at this last month, and at that time, that item was not on the list, and the reason is because we incurred an unplanned outage late November that now is something that we are addressing. We had an outage planned in the corporate operating plan for the fall of 2015. So the outage-related expenses are included in the budget, but the repair costs associated with some of the work that needs to be done is not. So we're working through this item at the moment, and we're trying to understand what the schedule looks like, the repair costs, but that cost of repair is not included in the corporate operating plan or the rate proposal. In addition, we have the installation of fossil generation basic emission controls. Here we're adding equipment to the back end of Nebraska City Unit 1 and North Omaha Station Units 3 and 4 to remove emissions to comply with EPA's mercury air toxic standards requirements. In addition, we have Fort Calhoun regulatory category. We're currently in the 0-350 category, and we're working through those checklist items to complete them and submit them to the NRC for review and acceptance. And we're going through that process as we speak. We hope to have this process complete in the first quarter of 2015 and then have Fort Calhoun return to the NRC's normal oversight process. In addition, we have increased regulations As electric utility, in an industry that's heavily regulated, we face a number of regulations for the operation of our generating facilities, including fossil and nuclear, the distribution of electricity through our transmission system, and also our distribution system. Beyond that, we look to construct transmission facilities. As our territory grows and we receive new load, we'll be adding facilities to serve that new load. We'll also be replacing aging infrastructure to ensure that we maintain a reliable system. And as always, we work to maintain a safe and reliable service. Looking at the summary of the 2015 budget, we can see that the total cost is $1,292.2 million. And that those expenditures can be categorized in several large classifications. The first classification is fuel and purchase power, and it's shown in the blue at $275.7 million, which is approximately 21% of the total budget. The next category is non-fuel O&M at $549.9 million, or 43% of the budget. Next, we have debt service, which is $141 million. That represents basically our mortgage payment on the facilities that we have financed. And that's approximately 11% of the budget. That's followed by payment in lieu of taxes at $32.6 million, which is 2.5%. And then to the capital investment side, this is where we continue to invest in the system to maintain reliability and to meet future load growth. That's $286.3 million, and that's 22%. And at the 12 o'clock position, you can see $6.5 million. That's associated with the completion of the 0350 checklist items at Fort Calhoun Station. Those items are then removed from the O&M budget, and I'll touch on that just a little bit later. When we look at this cost, the cost of operating our system in 2015, we compare that to the revenues that will be generated from our current rates. And when we make that comparison, our current rate structure doesn't provide quite enough revenues to meet that expense. And specifically, the variance is $14.7 million. So we need an additional $14.7 million to meet the expenditures that you just saw. Some of the drivers, or the main drivers of that increase, are increased nuclear expenses. First on the list is the Fort Calhoun Station refueling outage expense. That outage is scheduled for the spring of 2015. It's approximately $36 million. The next item is increased nuclear decommissioning funding. This is not as a result of the increased cost of decommissioning. This is a financial market impact. We have investments, and we make contributions to meet those future obligations. And as our investments are maturing and we're purchasing new investments, the return on those investments are less than what we previously had. And so as the yields go down on our investments, we're having to contribute more to meet that future obligation. The next area is increased benefits, expenses for benefits. Our benefits are not increasing. It's just the expense of the benefit. So several items here. The first one is healthcare. So OPPD, like all companies and the national trend, our healthcare cost is going up year to year, and we're projecting a 7% increase between 2014 and 15. The next category is related to pension related benefits. First, we have the retirement plan funding, and secondly, OPEB, other post-employment benefit fund. Both of those items are funded based on an actuarial calculation. So we have a liability, we know what the future benefit costs are going to be, we contribute funds, we invest those funds to meet that obligation. What's happening here is, good news is that people are living longer, and through longer lifespans, it's revising the mortality tables that go into the actuarial calculations, and through those calculations, because of the longer lifespan, we have to contribute more funds to be able to provide that benefit. The next item is increased capital expenditures. You saw the amount on the pie chart. That is up considerably from what we have funded in 2014. The major drivers there are some of the environmental costs around emission controls, also increased transmission, and some increased expenditures with regard to some of the structures at Fort Calhoun Station. So what have we done to reduce rates or the rate requests that we're asking for? First of all, when we're not generating electricity to serve our retail customers, we're taking that excess capacity and generating electricity to sell into the wholesale market. And through that effort, we're able to generate a margin, a profit, if you will. So if we look at the market price, we look at our cost of production, we'll sell in when there's a profit to be realized, and then we take that profit and reduce it to use it to reduce offset our expenses in an effort to keep our rates low. Next item is related to Fort Calhoun, and that was the information on the top of that pie chart. That expense is being taken out of O&M expenditures, and it's going to be amortized over a 9-year period. And so instead of having that cost in the 2015 rates, you only have 1/9 of the amount. The next item is also related to Fort Calhoun, and that's the outage-related expense. The cost of the outage I mentioned was $36 million, and through regulatory accounting that was discussed earlier today, we take that $36 million and we amortize it over the life cycle of the fuel. So 18-month refueling cycle, we take that cost and we spread it over 18 months, approximately $2 million per month. And what that does is it puts $16 million of expense in 2015 and defers $20 million of expense into 2016. That helps keep the rate down in 2015. In total, it's $115 million worth of mitigation. Now, the $14.7 million, when we apply this through our cost of service study, we then look at our rates and recommended rate increase by tariff and then by customer class. So the table in front of you shows each of our major customer classes, those being residential, commercial, lighting, and the overall average for all customers. Shows the current bill amount, the proposed bill amount, and then the total change and percent increase. Now, as we know, the dollar amount and the percentage changes based on customers' usage. So while this is an average, we know there's really no one out there that's average. But it's the best way we can find to compare or provide the impact. So on the residential side, the change on average is $1.63 per month for a total increase of 1.6%. Commercial, 1.3% increase. Industrial, 2.2. Lighting, 0.6 for an overall average of 1.6. Now you may ask, why doesn't each customer class receive the same increase amount? So why doesn't everyone receive 1.6? The reason is we do this cost of service study to determine what the cost is of serving each rate tariff and each customer class. And through that effort, we determine that some customers are pretty much on par with the cost in their current rate. Some customers are maybe contributing a little less than they should based on their cost, and some a little more. And so we take that into account when we design these rates. So the residential class is right on average. What that tells you is the residential class is paying its cost based on our analysis. The commercial class is a little bit less than average. And what that says is the commercial class is paying a little bit more than its cost today. So they get a smaller percentage increase. Industrial is paying a little bit less, so they get a larger increase. Overall, the increase is 1.6.
Edward, good point out too, that's not just the right thing to do, but it's also, we're legally bound by that as well, aren't we?
That's correct. We're required to provide fair, reasonable, and non-discriminatory rates. And what that means is our rates are supposed to be cost-based. And so we go through this effort to comply with the requirements that are placed upon us. In addition, we have miscellaneous rate and service charge adjustments that are included for your review and consideration. Under the charge changes, we have line extension cost for residential customers. We have disconnect charges and pole attachment fees. Each of those items is being increased based on our current cost. The increases are not large, but nonetheless, they're there. Other schedules, we have new street lighting options that are being offered and the elimination of one rate rider and the restriction of service under another. Now, last month, Tammy Monroe presented the features and benefits of the Economic Development Rate Rider. So today, I've included that information in this presentation for your consideration. First of all, the rate rider is compliant with the Nebraska Economic Development statutes. It applies to new customers that are locating within our service territory or existing customers who expand their load. And the amount of load that, has to be identified or measured to qualify is 2.5 megawatts or 2,500 kilowatts at a 60% load factor. The terms are for the discount period, 3 to 5 years, and then for the contract term, 2 times the discount period. So if there's a discount for 3 years, the customer is required to sign up for a 6-year agreement. If it's a 5-year discount term, then it's a 10-year agreement. The rate itself is a formula rate, very similar to our fuel and purchase power adjustment. And what that means is each year we'll take a look at that rate, we'll update it with the current information, and recalculate the discount amount if a discount is offered. The discount itself is limited to excess generating capability. In other words, we have to have excess capacity to be able to offer the discount. It's calculated annually, as I mentioned, and it applies to new and qualifying customers or expanding customers. And the discount itself is fixed for the term of the discount period. So once calculated, that 3, 4, or 5 year period is fixed. Just to give you a little example, a customer comes in 2015, applies for the rider, and the rider is offered. The discount is established, it goes into a contract, and then that customer will be with us 2 times the period in which he signs up for the discount. Another customer comes in 2016, and we still have excess capacity and applies for the rate. The discount that's offered in 2016 is based on the calculation that's performed in 2016, and it's set for the discount period. What's calculated in 2016 does not apply to the customer who signed up in 15. So you could have different discounts being offered over time depending on the capacity and the cost at the time the customer comes in. So in summary, it attracts new customers or new load growth to our territory. It improves the utilization of our existing capacity, basically optimizes the system. And in so doing, it helps keep the cost low for all of our customers. And it benefits the local economy. So as I mentioned earlier, if you remember on that slide, the actions to mitigate our rates, we take excess energy and we sell it into the off-system market to generate a margin. What we're doing here is taking that same energy that we would sell into the wholesale system, and we would provide it to a local company to use it to expand their operations, provide jobs and economic growth within our community. Today, states other than Nebraska or states within the Southwest Power Pool are receiving that energy, and we think it's better to keep it local if we can. Our public process and comment period includes presentations and discussions at our board meetings. So in November, we discussed this on the 11th and the 13th. On Tuesday, we had a conversation, not a presentation, about any changes that may have occurred, and there are no changes between what was presented in November and today. And then, of course, today is the 18th. The information has been provided through newspaper, television, and radio, and we've received customer comments on our website. With the rate increase, the 1.6, our average retail rate would be 8.53 cents per kilowatt hour. On average, I mean all customer classes. If we compare that to our region of the U.S., the West North Central region, the rate within the region is 9.48 cents per kilowatt hour. And for the nation, it's 10.65. So when we compare OPPD to the region and the nation, we can calculate that we're going to be 10% below the regional average within the region and 19.9% below the national average. For another comparison or perspective, we looked back 30 years to 1985 and determined what the average retail rate was in 1985. It was 4.97 cents per kilowatt hour. Now, why did we look back 30 years? We are a very capital-intensive organization or industry, and we construct and operate long-lived or long-life assets. And the typical depreciation term for a utility asset is 30 years. And when we finance assets, it's generally a 30-year financing. So 30 years is the right life cycle to consider for cost over a period of time. So in 1985, our rate was 4.97. Then we then look at our proposal for 2015 of 8.53. And then we look at the change, the annual increase amount between those two numbers for 30 years. And that's a 1.8% average annual increase. We then looked at the consumer price index, or the rate of inflation, which is 2.7% for that same period. And what that says is that in 1985 at 4.97, from that period to today, if our rates had equaled or increased equal to the rate of inflation, our proposal would be for 11.17 cents per kilowatt hour, or 31% higher than what we're requesting. So a couple of other ways to think about this. OPPD's rates have increased less than the rate of inflation, number one. And number two, on an inflation-adjusted basis, our rate in 2015 is actually less than it was in 1985, if you make the inflation adjustment. Now, the corporate operating plan and the rate proposals have been prepared by management. And as you know, you have two independent consultants who reviewed the work of management to provide an opinion to you. And first of all, there's New Gen Strategies and Solutions. They were retained to review the corporate operating plan. And they report that the expenditures anticipated by the district are reasonable and are the type that would be expected by a utility following prudent utility practices. And then we have CH2M Hill, who reviews the rate proposals. And their findings are shown here. We find the proposed rate changes to be fair, reasonable, and non-discriminatory. And then with regard to the economic development rate, the rate formula establishes the discount in a fair, reasonable, and non-discriminatory manner. Now, you have their reports and their comments for your review. In summary, OPPD's mission is to provide affordable, reliable, environmentally sensitive energy services to our customers. We believe that the corporate operating plan achieves that mission. Our rates remain below the regional and national averages. Expenditures are sufficient to maintain system reliability, and renewable resources generate 16% of our retail energy in 2015. We continue to look for improvement opportunities, whether we're managing O&M expenditures, prioritize and managing our capital investments, or identifying and mitigating risk events. Thank you.
Thank you.
Can I turn it back to you?
Question. Does this proposed rate increase, does it need to go before the Nebraska Power Review Board?
It does not.
Okay.
The Board of Directors has the authority to adjust rates. I'd also like to mention, too, that 1.6 is a rate increase, and a rate increase is a rate increase. We understand that. But I'd also like to point out that last year there was no rate increase. So this is, you know, the second year, and so we've worked really hard to keep our expenditures down. Yes, sir.
What you didn't mention is the amount of places that you look to cut expenses, and I think you've done a very good job.
Thank you.
Edward, can you talk about when you refinance some of those bonds, How can we see some of the savings? I know it's not immediate, but it's hard to bend the curve in this business, I understand it. But can you talk a little bit about what you did this year on some of the bonds refinancing?
Yes, sir. First of all, we asked the board for authorization to refund some of our existing debt. And the first authorization was for our subordinate lien debt. So we have several different lien structures. The subordinate lien, I believe we asked for an authorization of around $350 million. And if my memory is correct, we ended up refunding all of those bonds through two different market exercises, if you will, transactions. And as a result of that, we saved about $30 million of future interest expense on a present value basis. The second item is we asked for authorization to refund senior lien bonds. And we just completed that, time flies like a week ago. We haven't closed that transaction, but everything has been priced. The papers have been signed. We'll close it the first week of January and actually transfer funds. And through that exercise, we issued some new money, about $93 million to fund capital expenditures, part of that $286 million you saw in the pie chart. And then we also refunded $260 million worth of existing debt. Through that, we calculated that we'll save $26 million. So between those three transactions, we are saving $56 million. And that $56 million is spread over approximately 20-some years. So it comes out, you know, maybe $2.5-3 million a year. So it'd be nice to take it all one time, but it really helps over the long term.
Hey, Edward, it would be real easy to say, hey, the rate increase for the residential customer is only 1.6%. Hey, we could just kick this down the road for a year or so and worry about it next year and come in with a zero this year. Would you point out some of the potential ramifications and difficulties you would face from the financial end of the organization if we did do that, as far as the bonding agencies and so forth?
Right. So our objective, we have several. And, of course, we always want to provide excellent customer service. We want to have competitive rates. And we want to be reliable. And we want to be financially stable. And so what happens is you're trying to balance all of those items at once. And we have financial metrics that we've established that we believe are very important to us to demonstrate to the credit community and the people who buy our debt that we're financially stable. And one of those is coverage, and we've talked about that before. The other is our debt ratio. And then the third is our liquidity, how many days of working capital that we have. And so what we try to do is base our plans on staying within a range that would keep our creditors comfortable. And that's important because we have a large capital program ahead of us. We have $286 million worth of capital that you saw on that chart. And we have to go to the bond market to refinance or finance. And that allows us to go in and borrow at lower interest costs. And that saves us money in the long term. And that savings, as we just discussed, goes out over 30 years. And so if you didn't raise rates and you let your financial ratios decline, your financial stability would reduce. You would incur higher costs through the issuance of debt, which we have to do because of our capital, and that debt would last us over 30 years. And in addition, you know, we try to maintain a certain amount of working capital to manage through unexpected risk events. And we know firsthand that risk events do occur. So.
Yeah, I guess I'd just say, being new to this board, looking at a couple of years, but just those expenses to bend this curve, which we all get on management and people to do, when you look at the capital expenses, operating expenses, and now a lot of regulatory expenses in my mind, of course, you know, year by year, day by day, we're asking you to control those expenses. Nobody likes to do any kind of rate increase. And this is a public meeting. We act as these regulators. Some of the comments that came in, you know, no one likes it. And you got especially some of those people who are tough economic times, and it hits them hard. 1.6 sounds like a small number. We understand that, and no one likes doing this. But yet I think we've done a good job, and you talked about it with the bonds, of trying to bend that curve over time. It takes time on these capital, you know, it's just capital-intensive business. But I just want to make it, you know, publicly, we are trying all the time to bend that curve. We're on you. to control expenses, and every year we act as this regulatory body to do that. So I guess putting it out there, we continue, at least I will, I'm sure everyone else, continue to expect to drive those expenses down. And that's the challenge every year, and we expect it again next year. I think we've done a good job this year. So I just want to, it is a public meeting. I wanted to put it out there. That's what we expect, and we'll continue to expect going forward.
Any other directors?
Just briefly.
Brief?
Briefly.
We know you're an attorney.
What's that?
In our statutory functions as directors, when we approve the corporate operating plan, that's part of our responsibility to set the budget for the next year. For the utility. When rate increases or decreases come to us, we sit as our own public service commission. And that's how we view our role, is that management has to come to us and convince us that what they're doing is correct. And over the year, especially since before October, late summer, early fall, into this moment, the board and management have worked together to see what can be done about controlling those costs. And part of the controlling of those costs fits our function as directors on the corporate operating plan and our function as our own public service commission here. So this is how this the system was set up by our civil patron saint, George Norris, and I just thought I'd be a perfect opportunity to explain it.
Okay. If no other directors have any comments, this would be a time for the any members of the public who are here today who might want to address this. Obviously, this item number 8 is the corporate operating plan to be voted on separately, and then after that, we will vote on the proposed rate adjustment to pay for the corporate operating plan. So if you have any comments on 8 or 9, now would be the appropriate time. But when you approach the podium, please give your name and address.
My name is Laverne Trahan, 312 South 31st Street. I'm just against you raising the rates. You've raised the rates about 50% over the last 13 years. I wish you could eliminate your capital costs. So you have excess power you want to sell cheaper than normal. So you have dirty power that you want to sell because you have excess of it. I don't understand why you don't shut those systems down so you don't have excess dirty power to sell. And by doing that, you would, of course, decrease your overall expense and your overall capital expenses that you currently have maintaining those buildings and those jobs and buying that coal and all that kind of stuff. So it just always disappoints me that you're raising rates to manage the status quo, which you've done every year except for last year over the last 13 years, and it versus reinventing yourself as a clean utility, which is what I strive every day to bring to you that information. Thank you. Bye.
Thank you.
John Pollock, 1412 North 35th Street, Omaha. I am wanting to address specifically the structure of the rates. It continues to bother me that there is a discount per unit of the more electricity you use, the cheaper it gets. And I think there's a natural human tendency that if you say there's a lower price for doing something, it operates as an incentive. So to me, you are providing an incentive to residential customers to use lots of electricity, which will eventually reflect in your capital costs as people respond to that. I think that it should be closer to a flat rate. That I realize there is also a charge for operating the lines and so on and so forth, and you you have to find some kind of balance. But I also know that there's a human tendency to say, hey, something's cheaper. If you use more of it, you use more of it. Thank you.
We are sort of looking at that.
That's something that's really grass level or grassroots kind of stuff, John.
We are rethinking rates right now. If Edward can talk about that.
Yeah, I'm interested in the rate setting process. I mean, I've never thought of it that way.
You make an excellent point. And it's really an unintended consequence of our rate structure. If you think about to several months ago, we've provided presentations on rethinking rates in the amount of fixed costs that we have versus variable costs. And what's happening is the lower usage customers, everyone has the same per customer charge, but we're trying to make sure that people really provide the right amount of fixed cost recovery in their rates. And if everybody paid the same energy charge, then the larger usage customers would be overpaying because that fixed cost is getting spread and they would be overpaying. Okay. So this is a fair, reasonable, non-discriminatory item. And the way to address it is what we've been thinking about, and that is to increase the fixed portion of the charge and reduce the energy portion. And then that way you can levelize the energy cost. It's still hard because the fixed cost is so large, you can't charge customers the total fixed cost portion. Because remember, 70% of our cost is fixed and 30% is variable. Right. So that wouldn't be, I don't believe that would be acceptable for customers, but we are working on it. And we'll be coming back probably in the spring to discuss it some more.
Great job, David.
Good morning, John Atkinson, 4751 South 18th Street and Nebraska Wildlife Federation. It's a great discussion. I think most of us don't know how to think about it and don't know how the professionals who do it every day think about it. We did, I know I've spoken to the board at LES about this before, so no, I'm not picking on you first this time. But I know that in a rate-making process, you go at it from a cost accounting point of view, which is a specific flavor or method of rate-making. And you have your customer classes, and you try to attribute or distribute costs appropriately. Not many people in the public realize that one of the things a utility does is take into account that a very large customer might have a lot of the equipment on their side of the meter. They're not using as much of the service and the hardware and the infrastructure of a utility as somebody way out on the end of the power line on a small business or residential or whatever. So it's not as simple as it looks from over here, which is true of a pretty large portion of what happens in a utility. And it's not that I think the cost accounting approach is wrong. Obviously, you have to look at that or you're not going to do very well for very long. On the other hand, I think we also have to recognize a situation where if you're incentivizing the overuse of the product with that curve, it's not good from a number of points of view. And it really does require us to yet again ask of you to rethink the fundamentals of how you do your business, which is a funny thing to say from this side of the microphone, but especially in the period before we transition to more and more up to 99% clean energy supply, I think boosting reducing the price for the greater use of the power is the wrong thing to do. We need to find a way to incentivize lower use rather than incentivize greater use. In terms of the fixed charges, you see the power poles. You can't deny that there's fixed charges and expenses that cannot be parsed out necessarily entirely per class of customer. So I think the bottom line is that it's a hard thing, you know, to refigure. But I think we are asking, you know, that as part of this time of transition in the industry, and OPPD being a leader in that, that, you know, we do ask that the traditional forms of rate making that result in this kind of a curve, that we look at it again, and that it, you know, that we together figure out a better way to do it, because there's some things about it that make sense, and some things that we think are end up being not necessarily intentionally pretty going in the wrong direction.
Thank you.
John?
Good morning. I'm Dr. Scott Williams, 4036 Burt Street. I have comments about a couple other issues, but the thing that Edward had just mentioned a minute ago in response to Dr. Pollack's question or comment made me want to address the idea that looking at the rate structure of fixed versus marginal costs is a way to incentivize customer behavior. In the same way that, as John said, that making the next unit less expensive encourages people to use more power. And that's what his comment was about in general, is that it's not a good idea to encourage customers to want to use more power, because human nature is that if the next unit is cheaper, I'll get another one. When you go to the movie theater, the bigger the popcorn is, you know, the better the deal it is, and everybody gets a large popcorn when you don't need that. And we don't need that happening with power. We don't need to incentivize people to use more because it's a better deal, because it's cheaper. I mean, we're not the mega mart of electricity. That's not what we're trying to do. We're not. And I think that the response that Edward gave, that you intend to look at the fixed and energy or usage costs and rebalance that. I understand that fixed costs are 70% and energy costs are 30%, and that's probably something that's going to be distasteful to a customer's bill. I get that. But I think that increasing, as described, the possibility of increasing the fixed portion of a bill and decreasing the marginal cost of the next unit of electricity is actually going to have the exact same psychological effect that John was just warning against. That if the next unit doesn't cost more, that then you have an incentive to want to try and use more power. And so what I'm saying is that I understand that there is a disconnect between the fact that there are high fixed costs and low marginal costs. But shifting a bill towards higher fixed costs and lower marginal costs makes the customer think, well, there's nothing I can do about the first $85 in my bill. I have to pay that even if I don't ever turn the lights on. And then if I turn the lights on or run the fan or run the TV 24 hours a day, it only costs me $1 a month, because it doesn't matter if I use power or not. I'm going to use a lot more. And I guess my general comment is, please keep that in mind, what kind of a psychological effect you'll have on consumer usage behavior, on customer usage behavior, and whether or not what you're trying to set is incentives for people to use more power. Because I don't think that that's what the job of the board or the job of the utility is. The job is not to get people to use more power. And if what you're coming up with is mechanisms to try and encourage people to use more power, I'm asking you as a ratepayer and a voter to rethink what it is that you're trying to get your customers to do, how you're trying to meet the customer demand and satisfy your obligations as our public utility, because we aren't asking you to get people to use more power, no matter what mechanism it is that led you to that conclusion. If that is the conclusion, if the question you're asking yourself is how do we get people to use more power, you're asking the wrong question.
Doctor, I think you also heard Edward say that we're not, and I don't believe that we're incentivizing people to use more power. We're distributing the cost of the power fairly and equitably based on usage. It's not an incentive to use more. We have to do that, right? So we're managing those costs. Now, you've come up with a number of concerns. How would you fix it? What's your ideal for a rate structure that would be fair to all, responsible to all, and would cover our costs?
Sure. I think that what I want to do is I want to remind the board and the individuals here today who are going to be in the process of reevaluating the rate structure in the future, as Edward said, looking
but you
at
called that reevaluation improper. You said we're front loading with fixed costs, and thus lowering the amount of power, incentivizing people to use more power.
Mm-hmm.
So that dynamic doesn't work. Mm-hmm. Can you give me a reason or an example of a plan that might work in your professional idea?
Well, so my honest response right here is that I wasn't prepared for that kind of a question on this side of the microphone. So forgive me for not having a clear response this morning, but you know, next month I'll be more prepared.
Okay. Yeah.
But what I wanted to do was I wanted to remind and reiterate that point so that it is in your minds and our minds that what it is that we're trying to do. I just think that keeping in mind that the psychological condition of the low marginal cost of electricity can have the impact of using more. And I just want to hear
what your thoughts would be next month, because
sure.
That's the direction we're going.
Sure.
And if you're not comfortable with that, we want to hear your ideas, certainly,
sure.
But we also want to hear your solutions to that as well. So
sure.
I look forward to it.
I'll be happy to bring suggestions next time.
Thank you.
I think also in our strategic plan, everybody should remember that we do have a 300 megawatt reduction that we have asked to achieve along with that. So we are not trying to increase.
Yes.
We have a 300 megawatt reduction. We don't want to use more power, like you said.
Mm-hmm.
So we do have to balance this, and we're well aware of it. And we have to work more in energy efficiency projects to do that.
Yeah.
And that's where we're going to get it. And hopefully we'll have a report on that in the next couple months, how we're going to do that and how we're going to get the entire OPPD district and their customers to get behind us on this, and this reducing electricity usage. And that's how we're going to do it.
I do and appreciate and understand and respect the commitment that OPPD has made to reducing load demand in the 300 megawatt range. And I'm anxious to be a part of that conversation. So thanks very much for your time.
Doctor, what type of doctor are you? What's your background?
Engineer. Yeah, I have a PhD in engineering from Iowa State. Thank you.
Supervisor job.
No other comments. We'll go ahead and call the roll.
Barrett?
Yes.
Kavanaugh?
Yes.
Gay?
Yes.
Green?
Yes.
McGuire?
Yes.
Mines?
Yes.
Ulrich?
Yes.
Motion passed. Agenda item number 9, resolution number 6028. Now therefore be it resolved that the Board of Directors of the Omaha Public Power District hereby approves, 1, a general rate adjustment of 1.6% or $14.7 million, as shown on Exhibit A, 2, miscellaneous revisions to various rate schedules and service regulations as shown on Exhibit B, 3, revisions to OFFIT WAPA contract rate, all to become effective January 1st, 2015, and 4, the approval of the current FPPA rate, which includes an estimate of $27.8 million of prior year's fuel and purchased power costs.
So moved.
Second.
The motion and a second, Mr. Barrett. No, we have to pay for it.
All right. The purpose of this is to implement a 1.6% increase in retail rates. This includes a 1.6% general rate increase, no change in the fuel and purchase power adjustment, and various adjustments to miscellaneous rate schedules. And I think Edward went over this in his previous presentation.
Okay. No comments then for the board. This, obviously, we're on the last item. This goes hand in hand. Seeing none, anyone from the public? Seeing none? Oh, I'm sorry, John, go ahead.
So one of you made the comment that, gee, we raised rates every year for the last 13 years. Well, the 12 years before that, we didn't raise rates at all. And the rate increases came when we were in a building mode by building Nebraska City 2 and retrofitting the Fort Calhoun station with about $500 million worth of steam generators. In addition, one of those rate increases we could point to and say it was strictly the result of, I don't want to say anything bad about one of our largest employers in the city, in terms of energy prices that we were hit with at the last minute, that we had no other way to expense those costs out. So with the chart that you saw that rates are real rates below inflation. When you take that out, are less than they were in 1985. And That should be the message rather than, gee, it's another 1.9% increase, a 1.6% increase, 1.2% increase. The work that these people have done to limit it to that amount of money, given everything that's been going on, is really extraordinary.
I would like someday to see a comparison over the last 10, 20 years, what have you. Compare us to MUD, City of Omaha, Omaha Public Schools. See who's actually held the line more over a period of time as far as how much money is costing Joe Citizen every month compared to what it cost them 20 years ago, both for the schools, city, for your light bill, for your gas bill, what have you. I think we'd stack up pretty well. Okay, seeing no other comments, Kim, please call the roll.
Gary?
Yes.
Kavanaugh?
Yes.
Gates?
Yes.
Green?
Yes.
McGuire?
Yes.
Mines?
Yes.
Ulrich?
Yes.
Motion passed. Agenda item number 10, resolution number 6029. Now therefore be it resolved by the Board of Directors of the Omaha Public Power District that the proposed economic development rate rider as shown on the attached Exhibit A is hereby approved.
So moved.
Second.
This is deals with an economic development rider. The facts surrounding this is several potential large industrial customers are considering locating new facilities in the district service territory. Several existing customers are considering expansion of the existing facilities in the district service territory. With this, it gives OPPD the option to attract new customers and new load growth with an economic development rate rider plan.
And
Edward has previously discussed this. Are there any questions from the board members?
I'd just like to point out, I think is the fact is we're not operating in a vacuum here. We're in competition with other people with similar type plans, correct? And that to maintain competitiveness, this is another tool in our toolbox, you know, that's kind of thing. And it's a really good idea if we can attract jobs. Those people, you know, shop and eat and live here in Omaha area. I think it's a good thing.
Yeah. And Edward, with this plan, there are certain parameters that are built into it, so it's not in perpetuity. Or they have to make a commitment to use so much electricity.
That is correct.
Okay.
And we're also having a green rate rider coming up next month. Is that it, or when is that coming?
I think it's this
year. Is that part of it?
There'll be a presentation later this morning.
Is this coming?
Yeah.
Will that be by Tammy?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. What Director Ulrich says, I mean, we are trying to reduce, but yet we also, part of the job, I think, and our huge mission is economic development and helping bring businesses in. The right kind of use and growth is very good for everybody. I mean, we need those jobs and businesses to come here, and this is, as he said, it's a complex thing, and the field changes. We can't just do what we want to do when the rest of the world around us is doing something different. So the right use and growth is a good thing, and part of our mission, a big part of it. So I want to make sure we send that, or don't send a message any contrary to that, because I think we'd all believe OPPD and the work that all the employees do is very important to our communities and the state. So when we talk about reducing demand, understand, but the right kind of growth that we're incenting here, to me, in my view, as a director, is very important. So just want to get that on the record. Thanks.
Yes.
Is anyone from the public here to comment on this item? Seeing none, Kim?
Barrett?
Yes.
Kavanaugh?
Yes.
Gay?
Yes.
Green?
Yes.
McGuire?
Yes.
Mines?
Yes.
Ulrich?
Yes.
Motion passed. Agenda item number 11, resolution number 6030. Now therefore be it resolved by the Board of Directors of the Omaha Public Power District that the engineer's certificate requesting that the board waive the sealed bid requirements in accordance with Nebraska Revised Statutes Sections 70-637 through 70-639 is hereby approved.
Management is hereby authorized and directed to negotiate and enter into a contract for replacement process radiation monitors at the Fort Calhoun Station. And three, the notice required by Nebraska Statute 70-637 shall be published in the Omaha World-Herald.
So move.
Second.
Motion is second. Ann?
Okay, this is a proactive move, and it's on our budget for next year to replace our process radiation monitoring systems, which has been installed at Fort Calhoun Station. It's on our top number one list as far as health, as far as radiation monitoring. And this system is becoming obsolete, and proactively we need to replace it. It's going to be in two phases. Phase one requires replacement of 12 rate meters and the plant and control room, and with associated detectors and preamplifiers. This is with the 12 PRMs that were originally manufactured by NRC Abtech, and that has been acquired by Canberra, which is a subsidiary of Arena. They have been able to reverse engineer the electronics for this and offer replacement electronic packages that is going to actually fit into our original system in the plant, as well as fit into the associated control room panel. And this is going to save millions over getting over the other option of getting outside people to come in and set up the entire system. So this is a sole source contract that we're asking for. Again, this is just phase one. The estimate is $2,408,522. It's going to be phased in over next year or so, and then we're going to have a phase two, which will probably not be a sole source contract as far as replacing the two PRMs, the control room iodine monitor and particulate and iodine gas monitor in 2017, is that it? 16, yeah. So this phase one is going to be in 15 and phase two in 16. So I'd ask for the idea to negotiate and award a sole source contract for these components. Canberra.
Hey, Mr. Board, any questions or comments?
I just might point out, by using this sole source, doing the original vendor, we were able to have significant savings by not going in and ripping everything out. They reverse engineered it into the same control panels and everything, saving significant money.
Significant, yeah.
Anyone from the board care to comment on this particular item? Anyone from the public care to comment on this particular item? Seeing no one, Kim, please call the roll.
Barrett?
Yes.
Kavanaugh?
Yes.
Gay?
Yes.
Green?
Yes.
McGuire?
Yes.
Mines?
Yes.
Ulrich?
Yes.
Motion passed. Agenda item number 12, resolution number 6031. Now therefore be it resolved by the Board of Directors of the Omaha Public Power District that one, the engineer certificate requesting that the board waive the sealed bid requirements in accordance with Nebraska Revised Statutes section 70-637 through 70-639 is hereby approved. Two, management is hereby authorized and directed to negotiate and enter into a contract for replacement pump blocks for the charging pumps at the Fort Calhoun Station. And three, the notice required by Nebraska Statute 70-637 shall be published in the Omaha World-Herald.
So moved.
Second.
Motion and a second. Tom?
The purpose of this vote is to procure two replacement pump blocks for the charging pumps at the Fort Calhoun Station. Charging pumps are an integral part of the chemical and volume control systems, which provide for charging and letdown functions associated with the reactor coolant system. Replacement pump blocks are required for certain pump maintenance activities in order to keep the charging pumps fully operational. The current inventory has been depleted, and we need to replenish these pumps. Approval of the Board of Directors and the engineers certification and authorization to procure two replacement pump blocks from Energy Steel Corporation in the amount of $680,492.
Anyone from the public care to comment?
Oh yeah.
Thank you.
in response to this, $6.5 million, and what Mr. Green said about building out in the past, for every dollar you would have spent on efficiency, that would displace $3 to $5 worth of future energy costs. So instead of building more plants back when you were building out and having to raise our rates every single year since then, we would have reduced everybody's load by 60% to 80% instead. And these kind of costs would not be here. And the next cost for the turbine and the rest of these, you know, resolutions where you're spending all the way down these resolutions. So to tell me that you made a bad choice to build more coal plants instead of a good choice. And the reason I know this board knows this, because I ran for OPPD in 92. I've been testifying in front of this board since the late 80s, early 90s, always with efficiency, giving you buttloads of information on efficiency. You've never chosen to pursue it, so now you're straddling us with these bad decisions with higher costs. Thank you very much for the higher costs so we can continue to be the largest polluter in the state. This is bad and disgusting. You should have been pursuing efficiency for the last 30 years. You've known about it, and it's a shame that you haven't. But that's the truth of the matter. Have a good day.
Hey, seeing no one else, please call the roll.
Barrett?
Yes.
Kavanaugh?
Yes.
Gay?
Yes.
Green?
Yes.
McGuire?
Yes.
Mines?
Yes.
Ulrich?
Yes.
Motion passed. Agenda item number 13, resolution number 6032. Now therefore be it resolved by the Board of Directors of the Omaha Public Power District that one, the engineer's certification requesting that the board waive the sealed bid requirements in accordance with Nebraska revised statutes, sections 70-637 through 70-639 is approved, hereby approved. Number two, management is hereby authorized and directed to negotiate and enter into a contract with Toshiba to purchase turbine replacement parts for Nebraska City Station Unit 2. And three, the notice required by Nebraska Statute 70-637 shall be published in the Omaha World-Herald.
So moved.
Second.
A motion and a second, Tom.
Thank you, Chairman Kavanaugh. This is to approve the engineer's certificate to purchase replacement parts for Nebraska City 2 turbine. And I think I'm going to ask John Hansen to come up to the microphone and describe the situation and how it's going to be repaired.
Thank you, Director Barrett. And I'll refer to the screen here initially. And on November 28th, Nebraska City Unit 2 experienced a full load trip that was automatically initiated by the control system. And what we found subsequently as we took the machine apart, what you see here is the high pressure turbine and the intermediate pressure turbine. And as we cooled the equipment off, it came down from over 1,000 degrees. As we cooled it down and were able to remove parts, what we found was on the 10th stage was kind of the epicenter, if you will, of the damage. Right. And if you go to the next. So what you see here is the rotor, the high pressure turbine, which no damage was experienced on that portion of the turbine. And here you see the intermediate pressure turbine. In the lower right hand picture is a picture of just the intermediate pressure turbine. And there's five stages to this, or five bladed wheels. The middle section, or the middle wheel, is the 10th stage. And that's where, again, the most damage occurred. Normally, you would see blades here similar to the other four stages. And due to the event that occurred, the blades were basically sheared off. And as well as you have stationary blading in between each of these rotating wheels, and there was significant damage to those stationary parts as well. So we've extracted the rotor, we've sent it off to Toshiba, the original equipment manufacturer, or the OEM, up in Milwaukee to their shop. And so the reason for this resolution is we worked with other vendors to see if they could provide similar replacement parts at a reasonable price. Due to the proprietary nature of the design of the equipment, they are not able to deliver on a schedule that we were seeking, or a cost that we're seeking. And so we're saying that sole source is the best way to go with this. to get it done in a timely manner and the proper design. And so Toshiba has provided a quote for $1.2 million and about an 8-week shop time to do the work. And that's, as they get into the testing of the rotor that we sent them, that could vary a little bit, the schedule, but that's what we're looking at this point in time. Now, the fix that they've recommended is they will essentially grind off this 10th stage and leave it open, and they're going to replace the 9th stage blades and the 11th stage blades and beef those up. So in essence, we won't lose capacity on the machine. We will take a slight efficiency hit, which will increase what we call the heat rate by 8 BTUs per kilowatt hour, which is fairly minor considering the changes that they'll make to that shaft. The other option that we have, and we don't consider it viable, would be to have an entirely new shaft built, and that would cost in the range of over $4 million and take over 18 months to produce that. So with that, I'll open it up to questions.
Thank you. So, John, just a quick question. The length of that is, what, 25 feet, I think you said?
Yeah, 25, 30 feet.
Okay. And in layman's term, if that was in a motor vehicle, would that be the drive shaft or the transmission? Or?
That's a good analogy. That's correct.
Okay.
Yes.
And another thing is that plant can't operate without that.
That's correct.
All right.
And I will add that this shaft is connected to two other shafts that contain the low-pressure turbines, which are larger than this as far as rotating mass. That's also connected to the generator. So you have one long shaft that's producing the power, rotates at 3,600 RPM, revolutions per minute, and normal vibration is such that you could balance the edge of a nickel on edge on the bearings for this equipment, and it would stand there. So when you have an event that causes this kind of damage, that vibration, it's significant.
Any idea what that shaft weighs, John?
I'm turning to my experts here.
More than 5 pounds.
Oh, yeah. Many tons. I can get that answer. 25 tons, approximately.
Have we haven't come to any conclusions about why this happened, right? We're still investigating that?
That's correct, Director Ulrich. There's several things that could cause it, and it would be too early to speculate at this point in time. I will say that we're doing a root cause analysis up in the shop in Milwaukee. Toshiba has their specialists looking at it. Our insurer, FM Global, is looking at it, as well as OPPD has hired an engineering firm to assist us with that.
Yeah, I would think Toshiba would be very interested, because I'm sure this isn't the only one of those things they've got rotating around in the country.
That's correct.
And the other point I wanted to make was that we are pursuing insurance.
Yes.
If it's a viable option.
And that's what
that would be at our disposal.
That's correct. That's what FM Global's interest is, yes.
Don, when this all gets done and completed and reinstalled, can you come back and maybe, I know it'll be several months, but talk about how we then replaced the generation that we're losing, the marketing division. I think it'd be a good learning experience, probably.
Yes, we will do that. I will
adapt it in the marketplace.
Right. I will say that in the time that we've had, the time span since this tripped, the temperatures or the weather has moderated enough that we've been able to supply our own load with our native generation.
But next 2-3 months,
right,
maybe.
That's correct.
So, but it's a learning experience. And
yes, we'll come back with that. Thanks.
Thanks, John.
Thanks, John.
John, one quick question. I know that Nebraska City is partially owned, or we have a contract with LES and another utility. Does that impact the other companies?
That's a good question. We own the entire operation, the unit. The other entities are, we call them participants, and so they take half of the power that we produce from Nebraska City too, and they have different varying shares of that half load. And so we have been working closely with them, keeping them updated on our findings and what the repair plan is going forward. And so that's a good point. The other thing I will mention, and you'll see this in the other action items, is We had originally planned an outage in the fall of 2015 that would have been a boiler maintenance outage, and then we had an outage planned for 2017, which would have been a turbine overhaul. A lot of that work from both of those outages has been pulled back to now, since we do have the time with the machine open, and it makes economical sense to perform a lot of that work currently.
Anyone from the public here to comment on this item? Seeing none? Kim, will you follow up?
Jarrett? Yes.
Kavanaugh?
Yes.
Gay?
Yes.
Green?
Yes.
McGuire?
Yes.
Mines?
Yes.
Ulrich?
Yes.
Motion passed. Agenda item number 14, resolution number 6033. Now therefore be it resolved by the Board of Directors of the Omaha Public Power District that one, the engineer certificate, requesting that the board waive the sealed bid requirements in accordance with the Nebraska Revised Statutes section 70-637 through 70-639 is hereby approved. Two, management is hereby authorized and directed to negotiate and enter into a contract with BHA for fabric filter bags for the Nebraska City Unit 2 bag house. And three, the notice required by Nebraska Statute 70-637 shall be published in the Omaha World-Herald.
So moved.
Second.
Motion and a second. Tom?
This is to approve the engineer certificate to negotiate a contract to supply material for the replacement of approximately 17,000 fabric filter bags for the Nebraska City Unit 2 bag house. And I'm going to ask John Hansen to come up and describe what these 17,000 bags do.
Yes, Kim, if you'd forward. So we in Nebraska City Unit 2, here you, I'm showing a side view of the unit. Here you have the main boiler. The gas flow passes out of the boiler through the SCR, or selective catalytic reduction, which removes the NOx from the flue gases, travels through the scrubber, which removes the SO2, and eventually through the bag house. And in the bag house, you collect a lot of the particulate that's part of the fly ash that's entrained in the flue gas as it travels to the stack. In the bag house, you have, if you forward it, you have 14 different compartments, and you see the holes here that the gas travels through. Again, 14 compartments. I believe there's 1,200 of these holes in each compartment. And what we've had in the past is a cage that a sock basically fits over that, collects the particulate before it goes up the stack, and those sacks are those socks are pulsed with air. The fly ash drops down into a hopper, is collected and taken for storage out on the landfill. We found that we've had failures over time with these kind of socks or collection devices. And so our staff has worked closely with different vendors to find what works best and what will have a longer lasting life. And the next slide will show what we've come up with is more of a pleated type of a filter that will give us better efficiency and a longer life, we believe. And the current bags that are installed, we've found that they have what we call particulate blinding. And what that is the particulate becomes entrained in the sock and basically will not remove itself when it's pulsed with that air after time. And so what we found, or what we believe in our projections, is that by summer of 2015 that we would have to derate the unit by 15 to 20 megawatts if we didn't take any action at this point. So we believe it's in our best interest to retain the capacity, the full capacity of the unit, maintain compliance with our EPA regulations as far as particulate goes, that we'd spend this money with BHA as the vendor. And the estimated cost of this work is $2.5 million. And I will say that we have worked with BHA in the past, over the past operating cycle, to come up with the best cost. We have kept these bought these for our storeroom. And so right now we're buying them for the complete bag house replacement. So.
And John, this is what we actually were going to do this fall anyway.
That's correct.
It still was in our budget.
That's correct. Yes.
Thank you, John.
Seeing no one else, anyone from the public care to comment on this item, item number 14? Seeing none, again, please call the roll.
Barrett?
Yes.
Kavanaugh?
Yes.
Gay?
Yes.
Green?
Yes.
McGuire?
Yes.
Mines?
Yes.
Ulrich?
Yes.
Motion passed. Agenda item number 15, resolution number 6034. Now therefore be it resolved by the Board of Directors of the Omaha Public Power District that one, the engineer's certificate, requesting that the board waive the sealed bid requirements in accordance with Nebraska Revised Statutes, section 70-637 through 70-639 is hereby approved. Two, management is hereby authorized and directed to negotiate and enter into a contract with CRAM for the replacement of the third catalyst layer. Three, the notice required by Nebraska Statute 70-637 shall be published in the Omaha World-Herald.
So moved.
Second.
Motion second, Tom.
This is to approve the engineer certificate to negotiate a contract to supply materials for the replacement of a third of the third catalyst layer, the Nebraska City Unit 2 Selective Catalytic Reduction System. The negotiated contract is estimated to be $1,600,000, and I'm going to turn it over to John Hansen again for a further description.
Thank you, Director Barrett. This depicts the top of the selective catalytic reduction system or equipment. As was mentioned earlier, it is a honeycomb catalyst. The catalyst reacts with ammonia that we inject, and there are three layers. We replaced layers one and two in 2013, and we replaced this third layer in 2011. And it basically is the catalyst is consumed over time, and it will expire. We estimated the life of this would begin to expire or tail off in 2015 and would be ready for replacement in the fall. But with this outage, we think it makes sense to do it now again under the cover of the outage required for the turbine. The estimated cost of this is $1.6 million.
Is this due to EPA requirements or?
This collects the NOx, captures okay. The NOx, which is an EPA requirement. We have limitations of how much NOx we can emit from the unit, so yes.
Okay.
This is sort of a demonstration of the materials used to replace the NOx, the SOx, and the mercury.
There may be one more photograph there.
Replace my stock today.
This is what one section of a layer looks like, and there's many sections that go into a layer. There will be maintenance required to put this in, and we'll use a qualified contractor to do that work, and we did find out that the cost of that will be much less since they have time to vary their crews when they come in and do the work, and it'll be on the order of $300,000.
Thank you, John.
Hey, Tom? Okay. Anyone else on the board care to comment on board item number 15? Anyone from the public care to comment? Okay, Kim, please call the roll.
Barrett?
Yes.
Kavanaugh?
Yes.
Gay?
Yes.
Green?
Yes.
McGuire?
Yes.
Mines?
Yes.
Ulrich?
Yes.
Motion passed. Agenda item number 16, resolution number 6035. Now therefore be it resolved by the Board of Directors of the Omaha Public Power District that one, the engineer's certification requesting that the board waive the sealed bid requirements in accordance with the Nebraska Revised Statutes, section 70-637 through 70-639 is hereby approved. Two, management is hereby authorized and directed to negotiate and enter into necessary contract or contracts for SDA corrosion remediation. And three, the notice required by Nebraska Statute 70-637 shall be published in the Omaha World Herald.
So moved.
Second.
Tom?
This is to approve the engineer certificate to negotiate a contract to supply materials and services for the application of a corrosion coating on the interior of the spray dry absorber SDA vessels at Nebraska City Unit 2. I'm going to ask John Hansen to come up and give us a description.
This is to allow us to essentially coat the inside of the scrubbers. There are two scrubbers on Nebraska City Unit 2, and again, this is the piece of equipment that removes the SO2 from the flue gas stream. We spray lime in there, and it captures the SO2. It's a highly corrosive environment. The silos, the two silos, are constructed of a carbon steel material with a specified minimum wall thickness. And over time, you will corrode that material and reduce that the thickness of those walls. We have tested different coatings during the past outage and determined that a coating by the name of vinyl ester, which is a fancy name for an epoxy, will service well to reduce that loss of wall thickness. And we had planned to do it soon, anticipating that if we did not spray coat those walls, we would reach that minimum wall thickness by 2017. And so we will go out and we won't do a sealed bid process, but we will get bids to do the coating and receive the materials for coating. We estimate that work will be on the order of $1.5 million. So we will get proposals to do that before we select a vendor.
John, is that this application of the coating, is this because Nebraska City 2 is out for repairs?
Yes. I mean, that's why we'll do it at this point in time, yes.
My question is, are we going to need an outage then next fall, or is this going to, this is just taking care of some of the stuff that would dramatically affect the plant earlier?
This would have been done this fall.
Yeah, but are we still going to need an outage then in the fall?
If we get all the work done that we need to get done, this outage, we will not.
That is what we get done. Okay, yeah, good. So this may save us that fall out.
That's correct, yeah.
Wow.
And reduce a lot of the work that was planned in 17 as well.
Good.
Any other?
Yeah, if you get approved, right?
Yeah, thank you.
That is it?
Any other directors have any comments? Seeing none, anyone from the public here to comment on this item? Seeing no one, Kim?
Barrett?
Yes.
Kavanaugh?
Yes.
Gay?
Yes.
Green?
Yes.
McGuire?
Yes.
Mines?
Yes.
Ulrich?
Yes.
Motion passed. Agenda item number 17, resolution number 6036. Now therefore be it resolved by the Board of Directors of the Omaha Public Power District that the district's bylaws be and hereby are amended, effective January 1st, 2015, as set forth on Exhibit A attached hereto.
I so move.
Second.
The motion and a second, Fred.
Mr. Chairman, annually about this time of year we review all the bylaws, et cetera, to see if there's anything that we think might need revising. And this year is no different. We're recommending removing the term chairman or chairwoman and replacing it with just the term chair, and that applies to vice chair as well. A few other little incidentals about how we deliver our packages of information to directors. We've eliminated some kind of unnecessary language. And the main thing, though, I'd like to point out is the one change is happening. To change our quorum from 4 to 5. About 28 years ago, the board decided to add a board member to its 7-man board because the representative from Sarpy County thought he had to travel around in the farm country too much. Well, as a result of that, they added you. So adding the 8th member made it, and for whatever reason, they didn't feel at that time that they should change that quorum number, but a quorum should be a majority, and I've always felt that way, and we're recommending that we do change our quorum from 4, which would have been a majority on a 7-man board, to 5, which is a majority on an 8-person board, excuse me, 8-person board.
That's the main change.
The rest of this is all just kind of verbiage and housekeeping, clearing up correct language.
My only other thought is that the affirmative action, is that going to stay at 4?
The what?
Affirmative action, you know, for all, you know, board of directors shall require the affirmative vote of not less than 4 members of the board. If we change the quorum to 5, should we not also change the affirmative action to 5?
Mr. Breckner, what do you recommend on that?
That is at the discretion of the board. There is no need to change it. And I think the
longstanding reason for having affirmative action before directors is fairly obvious, kind of a common sense notion that for most, you have an 8-person board, which is somewhat unusual. To move forward, you'd want at least 4 members. But you certainly have the discretion to go with 5.
You do not need to in order to change. If you need to, we'll bring it forward. Yeah, that's a good idea. But we'll look at that. The committee will and report to the board next month or the month after about what we our recommendation on that.
Thank you.
Good catch. No, that's just a good catch.
Yeah, it was.
Anyone from the public care to comment? Seeing no one, Kim?
Derrick?
Yes.
Kavanaugh?
Yes.
Gay?
Yes.
Green?
Yes.
McGuire?
Yes.
Mines?
Yes.
Ulrich?
Yes.
Motion passed. Agenda item number 18, resolution number 6037. Now, therefore, be it resolved by the Board of Directors of the Omaha Public Power District as follows. 1. That a meeting duly convened on this 18th day of December 2014, his fellow board members and management desire to publicly acknowledge the distinguished service of Del Weber as a director of the Omaha Public Power District. 2. That the board wishes to express appreciation of Mr. Weber's invaluable contributions to the success of the district for the past 18 years. 3. That a certified copy of this resolution, suitably prepared and inscribed, be presented to Del Weber to serve as a reminder of his faithful and loyal service.
I so move.
I second.
Fred?
Mr. Chairman, before I turn it back to you, I just thought I'd make a few comments. As we all knew and were disappointed that Dr. Weber decided not to run for re-election in this cycle and is going off the board. Also, he's been unable to attend the last few meetings because he's having some health issues, and we miss his counsel and wise advice terribly. But I just thought I'd point up a few things that even I didn't know about, that when he first started his career, he was the assistant to the president of the Board of Trustees of the Cleveland State University from 65 to 69, and professor and dean of education at Arizona State University from 69 to 77. And as we all, most of us know, he ran UNO from 77 to 97 when he retired as chancellor. He was elected to this board first in 96, and reelected in 02 and 08, served all the offices with great purpose and dignity, and certainly provided this board a lot of good guidance and counsel, solid judgment, and a true leader of the community. And him and his wife, Lou Ann, have raised their 3 children, and hopefully they'll get to enjoy a nice retirement life. I'll turn it back to you, Mr. Chairman, for comments.
Thank you. As Fred mentioned, Dell can't be here today. He did send along a message that he has asked me to share with everyone here, the members of the board, OPPD employees, and members of the public as well. And this statement reads, I am sorry that I cannot be with you this morning. Please accept my apology. OPPD is one of the cutting-edge, forward-looking utilities in this country, and its future is bright as it moves into the exciting climate of today's challenges. It has been a privilege to serve on this board for the past 18 years. It gave me the opportunity to serve with board members who are dedicated to public service in general and to this utility in particular, and as well with some of the most talented professionals in the utility industry. The ratepayers OPPD serve can be very proud of their company. By any measure, it ranks as one of the very best in this country with regards to Del Weber. I remember Del's first meeting. I had about 2 years on the board, and I was a little intimidated because, you know, Del's a chancellor of the university, and he had been the chancellor when I attended UNO. And I referred to him as Dr. Weber, and he said, Mike, call me Dell. And he meant in a friendly way, and it meant a lot to me. It made it a lot easier to sort of deal with Dell. We've been fortunate to call him a friend, mentor, and an advisor, as well as a damn good board member. Dell didn't always necessarily say a lot of stuff, didn't talk a whole lot. But when he talked, we listened. Mm-hmm. And it's unfortunate he can't be here today. We wish him well, and hope for a speedy recovery. Is there anyone else from the board here to comment? Uncle Gary, sure.
From the point of view of the management team, Dell was an incredible supporter. You know, you think of words that describe Dell, and first one that everybody that we've talked to is class. Dell was an incredibly classy individual in the way he approached life. His wisdom was deep, but he shared it in a way that, you know, it became obvious you should have thought that, but, you know, gee, why didn't I think of that? But he kind of gave it to you in a dose that you could really swallow. And the last is his courage. He would step out. The reason that we're meeting in rooms around here, that he's changed a lot of things at OPPD, but also around the Omaha area, and what he's facing now with his health issue, that courage is still continuing to serve him. So, yeah, he's a great guy, and on behalf of the management team, we've had a great relationship with Dell and hope to continue to have that.
On Tuesday, we all recorded the verbal statements to Dell as to what we normally would be saying at this time. So our silence does not speak anything other than the greatest respect for this human being.
He did have a great sense of humor.
Okay, Kim, can you call the roll?
Barrett?
Yes.
Kavanaugh?
Yes.
Gay?
Yes.
Green?
Yes.
McGuire?
Yes.
Mines?
Yes.
Ulrich?
Yes.
Motion passed.
Okay, okay, the next item on our agenda, Tammy Monroe will make a presentation concerning our green sponsorship rate rider program. Tammy?
Okay, thank you, Director Kavanaugh. What we'd like to present this morning is a new rate option for your consideration. It's a green sponsorship rate rider. This rider was developed as an opportunity for larger customers to participate in renewable options. Now, as you know, we have a green power rider right now. That's under Schedule 463A. That's for residential customers, and 463B is for general service customers. Those are a one-year option. This option provides opportunities for larger customers as well as a longer term. Customers that would like to take service under this rate option have to take general service under rates 232, 240, 245, and 250. This option will allow them to purchase environmental attributes, and we believe this to this rate rider would provide customers the ability to meet their sustainability goals. We also are seeing this as an additional economic development tool. As was mentioned earlier, we have several large customers that have shown interest in locating in our service territory. And one of the questions we always get is, do we have green options for them? The rate was designed with two options. The first option is a formula rate, and we will update that based on our renewable energy portfolio as well as the Southwest Power Pool market. If a customer requests to take service under this rate rider, they will sign up a green sponsorship agreement. And under that agreement, they will have the option to say what level they would like to participate. So this option would be from 10 million to 40 million annual kilowatt hour equivalents. That's about a 1 megawatt customer at about a 50% load up to about a 5 megawatt customer. So that gives you the range of size of customer. They cannot exceed the attributes that they take cannot exceed the energy consumption for that customer, and they will be able to determine the length of the contract term, and we're offering from 5 to 15 year terms. Under this option, we are going to limit the amount that's available under this rate, or under this option, and it's to 10% of our renewable portfolio. The reason we're doing that is we've purchased our renewable portfolio as part of our commitment to sustainability at OPPD, and we need to retain a large portion of that for potential future regulations. So we believe 10% is the amount we can make available through this option. The second option is for customers that would like to request a larger amount than the 40 million kilowatt hour equivalents. This will be a contract option only. Again, they will be limited to whatever their energy consumption is. It's for new load, and it will be serviced from a new renewable resource. As I just said, we're limiting our existing resources, renewable resources, for our future regulations. So this would be a new resource. We would contract through a PPA agreement with the new renewable resource. OPPD would take the capacity and the energy and the environmental attributes. We would retain the capacity and energy, and then we would contract with the new customer for the environmental attributes. It would be a matching term on the contracts. And under this contract, if there's additional transmission or interconnect costs, those costs would all be the responsibility of the new customer. Now this, because it's a new resource involved, would require this board's approval as well as the Power Review Board's approval for the new asset. We are limiting our renewable portfolio to grow to 40% of total retail sales. And the reason we're doing that is because we do not yet have operating experience with larger capacities. The environment or the green sponsorship rate, in summary, gives large customers opportunities to meet their sustainability goals. The restrictions we have will also limit our operating risk until we gain additional experience. It provides a structure for OPPD to retain the environmental attributes we think we need to meet future regulations, and we think it will be a positive for economic development. We shared this information Tuesday in your committee meeting. We're talking about it again today, and then at the January meeting on the 22nd, we will ask for your approval. Thank you.
Can you expand a little bit about limiting to 40%? Because are we worried about reliability as far as the transmission grid, or exactly what are we worried about as far as?
Yeah, we're at 16% now. We've committed to go to 30% with the future purchase of the 400 megawatts. And so for reliability purposes, we want to just make sure we can operate a system with that much renewable in it. So 40 is what we're seeing from other utilities is kind of a benchmark to get to.
And we have to also work with SPP on that, is that right, Mo?
Yes.
You want to explain that a little bit? So.
Yeah, mainly because you cannot dispatch it. You can't count on it all the time. So SPP, I think they have a limit about 25%. But from our perspective, that's what we have the 40% for, to make sure that we can operate the system reliably.
And once again, this isn't in a vacuum, Tammy. This kind of green power, green star, whatever. Other states and other areas are also, companies are looking for this as part of the package, correct?
Right. That's exactly right. There are other similar programs out there, and we're just trying to be competitive with the rate options we're providing. Right.
And give us a scope about 10 million annual kilowatts. Isn't the average household 10,000?
I think so. Yeah. Is that right?
Yeah. So that would be like 10,000 homes would be the minimum.
Yeah.
And the 40, the second phase, the 40 million annual kilowatts would be 40,000 homes. So these are the big hitters that we're going after.
Yeah, this is our largest customer
base. This would be a significant addition to our economy if we attracted somebody that was using 40 million annual kilowatts.
Yes.
And can the same person who has a new economic development rider utilize the green rider?
Yes.
Right?
Yeah.
Which is a whole
thing. We're designing these in conjunction. Yeah.
If a big company comes in, suggest the green rider.
Right.
Get their green for free.
Okay, thank you.
Just gonna leave that. Okay, next item on our agenda is President Gates' monthly State of the Utility Report.
Thank you, Chairman Kavanaugh. Many of the items that I was would normally cover have been covered during the course of the board approval items, so I'll move through this quickly. We talked about Nebraska City 2. John Hansen briefed us on that and many of the items around that outage. NC1 continues to run well for the entire month and supports power generation. North Omaha continues to run well in support of our generation profiles, as do the peaking stations. Central Maintenance, which is our maintenance group that moves around between the stations, has been very active with 10 outages this month that they worked on, and over the course of this year they had 58 outages that they worked on and with a high degree of safety and support. With regard to Fort Calhoun, the unit did have an automatic shutdown, which I'll let Lou brief quickly on where we're at in the restart of that unit.
Yeah, thank you, Gary. As mentioned, about 10:15 yesterday morning, we did experience an automatic turbine trip, which results in an automatic reactor trip, and that is by design. The direct cause of that turbine and reactor trip was a main generator lockout. If you think about the main generator, that's where we produce the electricity out to the switchyard. So that lockout really protects the bus work and associated transformers for producing electricity, as well as we have some smaller transformers that we use to take electricity back in the plant for normal operations. So that that lockout was designed to protect that equipment. There's major equipment in there. What we have learned so far is one of those smaller transformers that takes electricity, and we use it to run equipment in the plant. A relay protection scheme on it caused that transformer to trip, and then ultimately the main generator lockout. The work that we've done so far, there is no significant equipment issues. It appears to be a relay failure. That relay failure, right now, there's small boxes that are outside on the transformers themselves. They're sealed from the weather. It appears there's a small amount of moisture in that box. We don't know if that was the cause, but we have been able to get it down to this specific relay. Overall, the plant operated as designed. No significant issues during the shutdown. The operators performed very well. And the plant, again, is currently in hot standby, and that's the condition that we'll maintain it right now with the expectation that we'll start the reactor back up tonight and then follow our normal sequence for putting the unit back online. So, again, that protective feature is important because it does protect major components at the plant. And again, we're systematically working back to make sure that there is nothing, no issues with either the connecting bus work or the transformers themselves. And our expectations, we'll have those transformers re-energized within the next hour or so. And then that sets us up with our normal sequence, as I mentioned, for a reactor and ultimately turbine restart. We also do take advantage of these times to look at any other maintenance that we might pull into this window, work that is currently scheduled for the refueling outage, but we systematically go through that. We walk the entire plant down, including the containment, to look for any issues post-trip, no significant issues as a result of that. And then we go through a very systematic process to establish the criteria for restart. And right now, expectations that would be later this evening.
Thanks, Lou. With regard to preparation for our refueling outage, which was mentioned earlier, it'll start on April 11th. We've got many of the refueling outage milestones have been met, and we continue to focus on that. That's a huge effort for us going forward. In the regulatory area, we did have an inspection called the TI-190. And it's for a beyond design basis flooding at Fort Calhoun. As a conclusion of this inspection, the NRC was pleased with the progress that the station has made to date. No major comments or observations were given. And so that's very good considering all the work that's got into the flooding prevention piece. We are looking at submitting a license change for some tech spec required surveillances, which we need to extend into the refueling due to our long shutdown, and that's under progress and expected to be received yet this week or next week, which will be great. We did go to a public meeting, which I referenced last month, that was going to happen on the containment internal structures. That meeting went very well. The integration continues very well with the Exelon system. We're sitting at 95.4% of the activities integrated with a target of 94.9%, so we're slightly ahead of that integration curve. In transmission and distribution, it's been a great month for putting some things in service and some plans in service for future growth, which we've talked a lot about economic development here. On November 17th, our substation system protection crews completed a project to construct a new substation at 144th and Schramm Road, and this is to support a new data center that's being constructed by Travelers Insurance. This substation included a large power transformer and two distribution circuits. It was completed 2 weeks ahead of schedule, and one of the distribution circuits feeds Travelers directly. One of them comes from another backup at 144th and Giles Road, and that was a major factor in attracting Travelers to come to Omaha, and a large part of the decision process to do that. Besides Travelers, the new substation will also improve reliability to the surrounding neighborhoods. Another substation located just south of Giles Road and 180th is under construction, and that project's on schedule for a June 1, 2015 completion. If you roll all this up to our system reliability rankings, OPPD is in the top part of the top quartile for reliability. Average outage per customer is less than an hour, and we're continuing our commitment to provide reliable power going forward. You heard about the great bond sale we had, which was led by Edward Easterland and the finance group, but it takes a whole company to do that. The whole organization contributed to the successful bond sale, and I want to thank all the men and women of the company that really contributed to that, because that should not be minimized. The ability to sell those bonds at the rates that we got speaks as an outside judgment of the performance of OPPD. We did get our Title V air operating permits for both North Omaha and Nebraska City. Were renewed by the City of Omaha and the Nebraska DEQ, and they're a renewal that has to occur every 5 years, so we're on track for that. Just some comments on the people and the team. We're a big participant in the Toys for Tots program with the U.S. Marine Corps. That always goes well every year for us, and this is no exception. Most of the toys that are collected here in this area go to southeast Nebraska, around Omaha and the surrounding area. We had an individual, April McClemens, who won the Wellness Award. It's very prestigious. It's due to her efforts in the wellness area, and was presented that by Governor Heineman on November 6th at the Light of Wellness Dinner. So that speaks well for a lot of our wellness programs and our folks that are here. Also, on December 3rd, we conducted a day of remembrance for 18 individuals in our company that have lost their life in service to this corporation. None since 2002, but that was held at the Syracuse Center. And I think if you don't remember those kind of things and work to prevent them, it's not good, and we do, and it was very, very well received. Director Ulrich attended that day of remembrance, and I know that it was very meaningful to everybody there. That concludes my report.
I'd just like to add on that comment, President Gates, that I was really pleased and honored to be invited to go to that. It was at the Syracuse Service Center, so the manager down there, John Moeller, knows me, but invited me to go. But I had highly recommended it to the directors, if you ever get a chance. Apparently, they're starting to do this on an annual basis, rotating it around. But it's it represents what I've always known since I've been on this board. This utility is only good because it's got the greatest people in the world to work for it. And to think about those individuals that actually died because of it to get us electricity, it makes you think about what they're doing when you call in and complain about your lights being out in a snowstorm. Because there's 18 people that died trying to get your lights back on. And I'd just like to say it was a very meaningful deal. I recommend it, attendance. In fact, we should be invited annually, maybe, given the option.
Thanks, Gary. Okay, the next item on our agenda is the opportunity for comment on other items of district business. Any members of the public who care to approach, I'd ask them to please, as they approach the podium, give their name, their address, keep their comments to about a 3-minute limit if possible. Also, please be civil and conduct yourself.
Sure. Good morning. I'm Dwayne Havorka, 409 310th Street, Elmwood, Nebraska. So I'm down in Fred Ulrich's district down in Cass County. I'm here today because a couple weeks ago, several of us were sitting around drinking tea, talking about the state of public power, and the news of the day was that Mr. Gates had announced his retirement from OPPD next year. And the discussion really turned on what a loss that will be, not only for OPPD, but also for the public power community in Nebraska. And somebody who's a lot smarter than me and dresses better said, you know, somebody should get that guy an award. And it became obvious to us that that was a terrific idea, that we really owed you a debt of gratitude for the years of service, the hard work, the dedication, the vision, and the leadership that you brought to your career, and also to your years as CEO. And so the idea spread fast, and groups came out of the woodwork saying, yeah, we want to be part of that. And we quickly realized we couldn't put all those logos on one token that wouldn't be so big that you couldn't carry it around, or at least, you know, put it on a mantle. So let me say that, and there are a number of groups that all came together fast, so I know there's a number of groups who also will likely want to be part of this. So on behalf of tens of thousands of Nebraskans who belong to, among others, Bold Nebraska, Energy Rescue, Green Bellevue, the League of Women Voters of Nebraska, the Nebraska Chapter of the Sierra Club, the Nebraska Farmers Union, the Nebraska Interfaith Power and Light,
Nebraska Wildlife Federation, Nebraskans for Peace, and Nebraskans for Solar. And you can see we got a pretty broad and diverse bunch of organizations in there. We wanted to say thank you. There's a number of letters already in this attractive folder that we'll leave with you. And we also want to present you with a small but heavy token of our esteem.
That's neat.
Which says, "In Gary Gates, in appreciation for your vision and leadership in creating a clean energy future." So thank you.
He could rival Derek Jeter for the farewell tour.
Yeah. Well, that, or I was going to say, you should get all the trophies and show them to Doug McDermott to say, "See, other people get lots of trophies."
John Pollock, 1412 North 35th Street. One of the things about being a meteorologist is that I get to be a stick in the mud when during periods of celebration. So that's my role this time. We're actually having a hybrid of two patterns so far this winter. The first pattern is the one we became familiar with last year, which we've got unusually warm ocean water both off the East Coast and particularly the West Coast. In fact, this year there's even more water off the West Coast than there was last year. That tends to produce high pressure over the western part of the continent, and the result is a plunging Arctic jet stream. We had that in November. It's coming back. Excuse me. However, we also have an El Nino going this year, and the result of an El Nino, this one isn't very strong, but it tends to produce a split jet stream. So instead of all the energy going into one jet stream, we have a southern jet stream, which takes most of the storms to the south of us, and another one, which takes most of the storms across southern Canada and the northern plains, and tends to keep the cold air bottled up in Canada. Since we're having a hybrid, what's going to be happening this time is that right now there's a lot of storm energy over East Asia. It's going to be transferred across the Pacific in the next few days, and our weather is going to remain seasonally mild for that period. And we did have our culmination of that already. We had a record warm minimum temperature of 52 degrees on the 14th, which tied a December record. Not that mild, but above normal. And then, starting early next week, we're going to have another storm system that's going to be winding up over the Great Lakes region. We'll get very little, if any, snow out of that. However, it's going to start pulling more cold air out of Canada again. That's going to wind up for a few days. And then behind that, there's going to be a second slug of energy. That's the one that we're going to have to watch out for. On approximately the 26th of December, that one will arrive. And that has the potential to produce a substantial snowstorm for the region. The timing, the way the models usually work, and they've been in agreement for a few days on this general sequence, which means that something like that is probably going to happen, even though it's quite far out still. What often happens, though, is that if it's going to be a really strong storm, that means there's even more energy in the jet stream than usual, and that tends to slow everything down. So if it's going to be a great big storm, it'll probably be on the 27th. If it's going to be a medium large storm, it'll probably be on the 26th.
And so no go on the White Christmas then?
No go on the White Christmas.
We'll hold you to that,
day after.
Okay.
Day after.
Okay.
And the other thing about it is that since we've got the cold air coming in first, there probably won't be an ice problem for us. It'll probably be all snow when it gets here.
Okay.
So that's what we're looking at. The other thing is that since this is a hybrid pattern this year, we don't stay stuck in it. Probably within a week after that, it's moved on somewhere else and temperatures start to recover again.
Thanks, John.
Thanks, John.
Good morning, Ken Winston, Nebraska Sierra Club, 4905 South 149th Street. The things you'll learn when you're standing at an OPPD meeting, both things about the insides of turbines and the latest weather information. So, first of all, I wanted to just start off with some congratulations, first of all, to Director McGuire and Director Gay for being re-elected to the board. And so I know that appreciate your service and glad that you're willing to continue to serve. Then the next thing I wanted to do was to echo the comments that Duane made about President Gates. Really appreciate your service and your leadership, your vision, and your work and the development of the energy plan that I really think is going to be, and I think it's going to get a lot of recognition nationally as being a leader in for the 21st century. And so we really appreciate the way that's developed. A couple of other things that I wanted to talk about just a little bit. Appreciate the idea of the green rate, and I guess I'd want to find out more about it before I get too excited about it. But the idea that you're helping to allow businesses to invest in more green energy, I think it's a great idea, and I also appreciate the fact that you're tying it to economic development, because obviously that is a factor, and a lot of businesses are looking for that. I guess the one concern that I have is I want to make sure that when we're talking about green rates, that there isn't some kind of message that renewable energy is necessarily more expensive, because it's not necessarily more expensive. And OPPD's own experience, Dean Miller can testify to that. I'm sure that your purchases of wind, your investments in wind, have been because of the fact it's the most cost-effective investment. The next thing I wanted to mention is I understand that we're going to be getting some information about the efficiency plan in the next month or two, if that's correct. We're very interested, and I know there's a lot of people who are very interested in that, would like to be engaged in that process. Want to make sure that there are programs that are directed toward residential users, and particularly that there are programs that benefit low-income people. And then the final thing that I wanted to mention is the legislature is going to reconvene, I think, on January 7th. And I know that I'm going to be working on some legislation. And if there's any legislation that we can work with OPPD on to help you make your energy plan a reality, we'd be glad to do that. So, thank you.
Thank you, Ken.
Yeah.
Good morning. My name's Tanya Ward, and I'm president and founder of Energy Rescue. And we are nonprofit 501c3 that help people when they get shut off by our utility companies. But today I'm here to also celebrate and echo our friends. And thank you very much, Mr. Gates, for taking care of us all these years. So Energy Rescue would like to also present you with a letter from us. And thanks. And I'll just read it for you and the public. It says, Dear Mr. Gates, thank you for your leadership as CEO of Omaha Public Power District and for supporting the Clean Energy Plan. Your recognition of our need to move towards clean energy is very encouraging. We appreciate you listening and taking the right steps to improve our futures. Energy Rescue is glad to be a part of this collaboration of caring people working together to help the clean energy plan for OPPD become a reality, and wish you all the best.
Thank you.
You're welcome, sir. And it's for you.
I want to comment just a couple of things. You know, I'm humbled and honored to have that recognition, and thank you, but can't take the credit for it. There's three major groups that really drove the vision and where this corporation has been, is, and is going. And that's the board of directors, who really did set our vision, and they do push, they do question, they do challenge, and it's all healthy, and that kind of healthy tension is necessary. Second group's the men and women at OPPD, particularly the senior management group. They drive everything from day-to-day operations to what we do strategically and move forward in our vision. And the third group's all the stakeholders, and that's all of you folks. You know, you've provided a lot of push along the way, a lot of thought. I know from time to time you may not think we're listening, but we are. I've got notes for every meeting. And so that's the three groups that really ought to get credit for where this company's going, and where it has been, it is, and where it's going. At the board, the men and women here, and the stakeholders that continue to become involved in our company through our process, and I appreciate that. So I do appreciate the honor and the recognition, but it's not the credit. That goes to those groups. I just wanted to say that.
I have one thing I want to mention. There are not many CEOs that when the inconvenient truth, Al Gore's inconvenient truth came out, that the CEO, quote unquote, invited all of his VPs over to his house for dinner.
Burke's house.
It was at Burke's house. But they sort of said that, and they said, we're going to watch this together. They gave him a drink. They gave him some food. And they said, we're watching this. So, you know, there were many CEOs who sort of coordinated that.
Scott Williams, 4036 Burt Street. First and foremost, I wanted to echo the comments that have previously been made in thanking President Gates for his years of service. We appreciate the leadership that has gone in, even in light of the comments you've just made about the gratitude that is due to the board and the rest of the organization. We in particular appreciate your leadership in helping guide OPPD into a new clean energy future plan. So thanks very much for your service. I have two comments in general, and both of them are things that I would like to request that there be forums for further discussion at another time, because I recognize that public meetings of the board are not always the appropriate juncture for commentary and feedback and active discussion. In the first case, I joined the committee meeting on Tuesday as a listener, as the public is entitled to, and I noticed that throughout the entire process it was an open meeting, except for the very last section, which was the succession planning. And I respect the necessity for privacy in succession planning, but I'd like to request whether there would be any opportunity for public input in the type of planning that the board is undergoing. I don't know what this process looks like, because as I said, there was no opportunity for public to even listen during the committee meeting. But as this goes forward, I'd like to find out if there is an opportunity for the public to weigh in on the type of planning that the board is undergoing for the future of this organization. As a recommendation or an option that you could explore, you might consider looking at something like a university who, when searching for a chancellor, for instance, might look to have stakeholder meetings with potential candidates. These are the kind of opportunities that might allow for members of our public, ratepayers, and citizens and voters to be able to weigh in and offer opinions in searching for the individual that will lead our public utility into the future.
Well, we are considering several candidates, both internally and externally as well. Mm. And one challenge we face with including external candidates are that they're most likely going to be employed at this time somewhere else. Mm-hmm. And obviously that can create a very awkward,
yes,
hazardous situation at times in their current employment.
Yes.
So
while understanding the need for transparency, we also understand the need to, if we publicize our candidates, we will greatly diminish the number and quality of potential applicants. We feel our biggest task at this point is hiring the best person for the job. So that's going to be number one, and that by far. So there will not be any public meetings, if you will, involving the candidates.
Stakeholder process.
Stakeholder process, we have been... Well, why don't I defer to... Lisa? Is Lisa here?
Yeah.
Lisa. Lisa. Okay. Could you maybe handle it for me, Lisa?
I'd be glad to.
At the request of the board, they hired Carl Mykoff, who is a 40-year veteran in the utility business, and we sat down and talked through some of the key stakeholders, really a lot of elected officials, because they, too, represent the constituents here in the audience. So we have been meeting with strategically placed across the district individuals during this whole entire week and next week as well. And then Carl will provide that confidential information back to the board so that it can be a data point, really, when they're making their selection. Is that, Chairman?
Sounds fine. Thank you very much.
Is there the opportunity then for individuals to contact Carl and offer input, or is this...
That's up to the board.
It probably part of your task is to let us know what you think, perhaps.
Well, I think we have OPPD listens.
Okay.
I don't know why we don't open that up to OPPD listens. Anyone who would want to add comments, on OPPD listens, that's the easiest way.
Sure.
You can.
Okay.
I
respect your position as the chair about the necessity for confidentiality in searching for the most, the best candidates we can find for the position. And if there's the opportunity for the public to have input in the process of selection criteria, even if it is not with direct interaction with the potential candidates, as you said, for the need for privacy, I think that ratepayers would be pleased to be able to have the opportunity to know that their voices are being heard during this process, because I think we all recognize that the position in particular has a particularly strong impact on the direction of our utility. So.
Would there be OPPD listens? How's the best way for the folks to access that? Just do it online?
It's right on OPPD.com and OPPD listens, so you Google it or whatever, and it pops right up.
I always see positive stuff about myself all the time.
Is there any degree, I'm sorry, I'm not particularly familiar with OPPD listens in this case. I don't know if there will be any degree of a type of reporting or conclusions or something that is drawn from that, or if it is just a one-way channel where people offer comments and then that is given to the members of the board and the selection committee. I don't know if there will be something that is generated that summarizes that these are the most common things that people have said through various channels, talking with Carl or OPPD listens, that utility ratepayers are looking for in the succession process.
Well, that's,
I think we could do that.
I wouldn't want to do that before the selection is made. Possibly post-selection, we could ask Lisa to give some type of a recap or synopsis of what the common concerns were, what the common... desires were for a seat.
Sure. I think people just like to feel like they know that their voices have been heard, because one-way channels oftentimes don't guarantee that you feel like your comments were taken into consideration in the process. And so if a summary after the selection has been made and publicized is a way to respect confidentiality while still making ratepayers aware that their voices are being heard and considered during the process, that might be a reasonable compromise.
Interesting.
Thank you. I appreciate that. As I said, I do have two things that I wanted to comment on. This is the first issue. The second one regards the direction that has been taken by OPPD towards a commitment to reducing 300 megawatts of load over the coming years. And I have, not surprisingly, some technical questions. And I know this is probably not the forum to address that. For instance, It's unclear to me at this point from the information that I've looked at whether 300 megawatts of reduced load comes from a particular point in time now, or if this is 300 megawatts of reduced load from the expected load increases that would be occurring between now and the target year, or how the measurement of 300 megawatts of load is being measured, and whether any of the things that have already been, any actions that have already been taken are accounted for that 300 megawatts.
Tim, would you care to comment on that, please?
Well, I can certainly meet with you afterwards and kind of explain kind of what we're going to be doing. We are going to be making a presentation to our senior management team on January 6th, and then providing a presentation to the board in January as well on where we are on the portfolio of demand-side management and energy efficiency initiatives, both on the commercial industrial side as well as the residential apartment, landlord, low-income components of our plan.
Sure. So, I mean, for instance, one of the things that I think would be an important consideration is that if residential represents one-third of total demand through the utility, that I would like to know that the type of incentive structures that are being set up are representing one-third of the incentives going to residential customers. Because I know that we talked about earlier the fact that commercial and industrial business represents a large fraction of the load, and they also represent larger users, represent lower marginal costs, which represent easier opportunities for savings. And I appreciate and respect that, and that can oftentimes be the lowest hanging fruit. But I would like to think that incentives are being proportioned out with respect to the fraction of power that is being used, and that residential customers are receiving an appropriate incentive to actually be saving.
There were incentives throughout the the organization, throughout the district. Mm. At the time, you know, we asked a number of critical questions, including, you know, why 300 megawatts? Why not 400? Why not 200? You know, and the management did their homework, and we came away confident that we will meet that goal.
Sure. Well, I'll look forward to speaking with Tim maybe after this, and then also to the presentation in January as well. Mm-hmm. Thanks very much for your time.
You guys have a good question. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Wow, that was fun. Laverne Drayan on 31st and Davenport. I just want to say I love the TV screens that you bought, and I really hope that you give us access to it so when we give our presentations for 3 minutes, we can use graphics, and we could also bring in satellite experts, people who are in the field that are opposite of, you know, clean energy experts, for an example, to, like, emphasize my points about what I've been saying all these years. So I really hope you give us access to these so we can give you presentations that are full on versus us just trying to explain something. I talked to Gary about it. He said he was going to look into it. But with his retirement, maybe, and he won't have time, I just want to put a bug in your guys' ear. And I'll just tell you right now, the criteria I want your new CEO to have is somebody who's experienced in microgrids, somebody who's experienced in renewable energy, and somebody who's ultimately experienced in energy efficiency to change this utility from the largest polluter in the state to the least polluter in the state. And I like some of your initiatives. Some of your ratings are crashing into each other. You know, we have too much capacity. We got to lower the rate. If you want clean energy, we'll build more capacity. All that stuff seems a bit confusing, but I know that's coming in the future, and I'm not worried about it. But I just told you what I want as a CEO, somebody who's, and I'm probably thinking somebody young, even though I'm 53, you know, somebody who has an experience. I know OPPD has our CEO because you did invest in nuclear power and you did need a nuclear engineer to sort through the issues over the years. So with the new technologies, I hope you do the same thing, bring somebody on board who knows about efficiency and renewables and smart grids and all that. Thank you, and have yourself a wonderful day.
It's kind of like picking a doctor. I've always said, I don't want a guy older than me. He's too old. Anybody younger than me, I figured, doesn't know anything yet. So it's kind of hard to find somebody your exact age.
So you get high school classmates.
Sure, I do. Okay, well, seeing no more comments, long meeting, appreciate everyone's patience. And Merry Christmas to everyone. We're adjourned.